I am here with Rob Hainso and Jonathan Tweet, designers of the 13th Age role-playing game. And we have just smashed through our goal of getting 13 new subscribers to 13th Age Monthly. So we're going to have a very special subscribers-only Q&A. How does that sound, guys?
Sounds great.
Excellent.
Subscribers-only, and because we delayed for a while, the longer we delayed, the more questions Simon and Wade kept on putting into the queue, considering themselves subscribers. So subscribers, you got a procrastination bonus.
Well, the first question is not from Simon or myself, and it is as follows. I felt that fights as written are very easy. With an inexperienced group, I can often throw 150% fights with the monsters using nastier specials without the players feeling too challenged. Is there a better way to build encounters to improve the challenge other than just using more monsters?
You first?
Yeah, you can use monsters that deal more damage or increase the amount of damage that the monsters are going to deal. That speeds up a battle faster than just throwing more monsters in. You can use higher level monsters, but then their defenses and their hit points go up, and so that also might slow things down. So mostly it's increasing the damage output of the monsters. It'll make your fights tougher without necessarily making them longer.
Now, the thing about increasing the damage output of the monsters, one question, and I probably should have followed up with questions on stuff like this, but one question to ask is, are you mainly using monsters from the core 13th Age book? And I say that because there are a bunch of monsters in the core book that have, you could call it more forgiving damage numbers. And usually what actually happened is that, like the Hydra, Wade just wrote Temple of the Sun Cabal, a really good adventure that's coming out on 13th Age Monthly this month. And for a change, I've actually edited it and developed it, and it's all ready to go. It uses a Hydra. And in 13th Age core book, the Hydra doesn't do enough damage. Because mainly, I think that I'll use the word I got a little confused about damage math on the Hydra. And using the right damage math that we've actually used in 13 True Ways and in the Bestiary, the monsters in those books are not going to make the same mistake, you know. So if a game master goes from just using core book monsters all the time and then like starts using the exact same number of monsters from the Bestiary all the time, I have a suspicion that the fight is going to be harder with the Bestiary monsters in 13 True Ways. And for instance, in the Temple of the Sun Cabal, you'll see what an actual Hydra statted up with the right amount of damage looks like. And the answer is, it's going to scare people rather than being like, oh yeah, we got this. Because I remember like with you guys running against a Hydra, people are like, are we even fighting this thing? I mean, I'm just killing it. It's like, yeah, that was too easy. The other biggest question for somebody who says that the fights are too easy is, are you running four battles as an adventuring day? You know, are people only getting a full rest after four battles? Because what I find is that when I'm running games at a convention and people don't know what they're playing, I can still pile things onto people. And as long as the characters are high enough to have a couple daily powers and stuff like that, you can go ahead.
Because at a convention, there aren't a lot of fights.
There aren't a lot of fights.
And so the fights can be super tough.
And running games at home, it's like, if you, let's imagine that you're just playing every time it's two fights, or at most three, but if it's just two, player characters can blast through with what would amount to a Pyrrhic victory if they were doing all four. And so I find, you know, I finally, for the first time in how long? A long time, had a full player character death last session. I've gotten really rigorous on, no, you're not getting that full rest until the four battles. And I don't care how tough they were. Yeah. You know, you were tough. They were tough. Oh, congratulations, you won. But that last battle, last time, I mean, people die. I think people died because
we were run thin.
They were out of stuff. Yeah. And so my question for the subscriber really is, are you really doing four battles? Because if you're doing four battles, and you're doing time and a half, you know, monsters and a half, and you're using all the nastier specials, then your player characters are really, really good. And I, at that stage, I'm kind of like, well, a tip of the hat,
And really, if they're that good, you can always make them house rule it and make them go for 5 battles before they get a re-up, and then they've got to use
five their battles,
resources.
Yeah. If they're that good.
If they're really that good. If they're doing 4, and that's no problem, make them do 5.
And, in fact, remind me when we get to another question. I think I saw a question on this list later that also plays into this.
Right.
The recharge question.
Yeah.
Because then we can hit this then, too.
Yep. Well, before we get there, we have a question about making fights more dynamic. Do you have any tips for making fights more dynamic? 4E had great terrain effects that could affect the battlefield and force the players to move around the battlefield. Do you have any ideas on ways to affect the battlefield that aren't only traps?
So I'll go first.
Sure.
A couple tricks for getting people to care about their location are things like, you know, you have a monster that deals damage to everybody adjacent to it at the start of its turn. So everybody, maybe they want to hit it when it's their turn. They want to fight it, but then they want to use their move action to try to get away from it so that when its turn activates, it doesn't deal them all that extra damage. And abilities like that can force players to
act differently.
Use a different kind of monster or a different monster special ability to force characters to move.
And you mentioned the Smoke Devil as an example of that in 32 ways.
Smoke Devil's a cool example. It does double damage if it's attacking somebody who's alone. And so then position really, really matters, because if you get hung out alone, as happened to me when the Smoke Devil's attacked, you take a lot of damage.
Or later tonight.
A battle with Smoke Devils really feels different, because there's such a big difference between facing one by yourself and facing one with somebody else there with you.
So that one is pretty much a case of whether or not we provide monsters that can make that kind of thing happen. And certainly, as we learn more about making monsters, like 13th Age and Glorantha, I think has actually, you know, that frequently comes up. Yeah. I mean, like the Woctopus, for example, the Dragon Snail, both have things that make it very different whether or not you're engaged, and both conditions create different problems, you know? And so I think that's an important part when we do monster design.
Lots of problems.
Problems that are different depending on location.
Yeah.
Now, the fact is, obviously, the most monsters haven't been designed precisely that way. And so, in terms of published products, I thought that the... Wade, did you write the stuff on terrain in the GM screen pamphlet? That was you, wasn't it?
That was not me. That was Cal Moore.
That was Cal Moore.
Yeah.
And it was... Okay. So, the compliment that I was... Wade, you did great work on it, but not on that part. Cal. Thank you, Cal. I learned a lot from what Cal wrote in that part of the book. And it's partially because I think as players in my game will attest, I don't use terrain that often.
Yeah.
But Cal was really writing partially about give an advantage to position, then try to make it obvious to the player characters that they can gain that advantage if they go there. Now, when I'm running games, I frequently am doing a different model of that. I'm making it clear that the monsters are accomplishing something that the player characters need to stop. I'm using more monsters than there are player characters so that the player characters get engaged and therefore supposedly pinned. And while the monster is accomplishing a task, the non-player character priest is doing a sacrifice. Someone is opening up, you know, doing a ritual that is going to make things much worse if they succeed. And then the player characters need to, like, figure out how to simultaneously handle the fight and deal with that problem. I mean, I use that trope a lot, and I think that I also use the running away piece, because if I can get a monster to actually physically escape the fight, then I will make what happens later on worse for the player characters. Now, I think my players know that and go to extreme and crazy lengths to track down fleeing monsters, you know. And so it doesn't work out that well. But that's certainly an example of, you know, you don't have to have every fight be to the death if in the middle of the fight, the monsters that matters, no, cover us, we're out of here. And then you make it clear that what happens later on is because of that problem. I think that the trap example is, the impromptu damage stuff leads to the trap examples. But I think that the GM screen pamphlet booklet
forget exactly what it's called. The book that was part of the GM screen has some really good advice on terrain in 13th Age.
All right, the next question. How are recharge rolls supposed to work? After every battle or only after the battle in which you used the power? The books give both answers and never really says which is right.
And the funny part is, we even discuss the fact that we change each other's minds.
So, I mean, I think there are two right answers.
Yep.
Mathematically, the right answer is you want to make one recharge roll and the rest after you used it, and that's the only shot you've got. Mm-hmm. And that, the math works out nice and what have you. But emotionally, players want to roll those recharges, and who are we to say no?
So, one answer to that is, and I think you may have noticed me doing this lately, is that I feel like if the player characters have really accomplished really powerful things and done well, I will say, go ahead and roll a recharge for the things you used earlier in the day. You know, that was, that like, as a reward, as an accomplishment in a certain sense. I think because by what I'm doing is I'm using your original method, as the general, and then as a reward, going, okay, you know,
sometimes you can.
Sometimes you can. And I find that to be satisfying and a sort of a way of making it clear, you know, for instance, after that last session when somebody died, if that had been the middle session, no one's re-rolling their recharges.
Yeah.
No, sorry, you know, not going to happen now.
Just the ones you used that battle.
Just the ones you used that battle. Not the previous ones. You used that battle, but not from before. Yeah. Whereas a lot of other times people deserve to go ahead and, let it roll. One other aspect of this is that the first question, which was about, which was the person asking, was saying, look, I think the math is too easy.
For fights. Right, battles.
If that's, in that campaign, roll recharge once, period. Yeah. Don't roll recharge later on.
The characters are already kicking butt.
Characters are kicking butt. They don't need to be given, maybe, you know, that would actually explain partly why they're kicking butt.
Yep.
So.
Well, the next question is more of a campaign question. 13th Age stories often can be about the rise or fall of one or more of the icons and the ramifications of that change. When would you time the actual change in a campaign?
So my answer is like 30 seconds before the campaign starts, right? So the campaign starts and the Dwarf King is dead! What are you going to do? And then you immediately hook the players with something big and they know that this campaign is not like any other campaign. And off you go. And I think you need to know what all the players are creating for their characters first. You need to know their uniques, and you need to know their icon relationships so that you know whether it makes sense for the Dwarf King to be killed or whatever the plot device that you think it's going to be. Because really, the campaign's got to be about the characters.
Yeah.
And, but then after you see what they're bringing to the table, you decide how things start. And I would say start sooner rather than later.
That seems like a... I mean, when I say another example, I think I agree with yours. I think that's perfectly good. It occurs to me that I haven't really done that. It makes total sense to do it, but I haven't. I've usually made it something that shifts, like when the player characters change a tier or something, where they're sort of like, okay, well, you had a new level, you're at a new level experience, and the world has shifted.
There are plenty of right answers to that question. Plenty of good times to have a big change.
In fact, I think the only warning about it is make every shift count and you don't have to shift many to make a difference.
And ideally the characters have some influence. Like, so another way to think about it is you've got this, maybe the Dwarf King will live and maybe they'll die, but it's you don't know, and it's this big thing and the characters have to be involved in order to make it turn out one way or another. Mm-hmm. That also works.
You did a campaign where the Archmage people working for the Archmage were the actual final villains.
Yeah.
But we didn't discover that till the very last minute of Epic.
Yeah.
So, which was a great final reveal. It was all along.
Ba-ba-ba.
Yeah. So.
Right, the next question is about monster design. Very specific monster design. The question is...
You're looking at me.
I'm looking at him.
Yeah, okay.
I can't imagine why you'd be looking at me.
What,
it's almost as if I submitted it.
Oh, there we go.
I love the Beholder.
Oh, geez, that is specific.
But as a non-OGL monster...
Hey, man, our PR guy wants us to design a monster.
Not in 13th Age. How can I create a fun... Well, I'm just... I'm not going to make you do it. I'm very much do it yourself. Oh, yeah. So I'm just seeking your sage advice. How can I create a fun-to-fight homebrew beholder that's not just reskinning the Prismatic Ogre Mage, which was my first thought, and then do you have any advice on how to build a battle with that kind of monster?
Me first?
Go ahead.
You're asking me to not design it?
Well, I mean, you can design it if you want.
Yeah, what advice would you give him?
Okay, first advice is the whole beholders are about anti-magic with the big blinking central eye. Anti-magic is also possibly a little bit anti-fun. So let's make it fun.
Excellent.
No. You see, the Jonathan approach would be like, yes, cut it all down. Player characters armed with butter knives.
All their magic items melt.
Yeah. So what I would say is every time you're using a spell or any magical effect, roll a save. If the save succeeds, you get half the intended effect when the beholder centralizes on you. If the save fails, you do not. And in fact, the game master gets a small improvisation as it fizzles. So, you know, you're casting magic missile and it fails. You know, it goes off and random directions and something fun happens. Make it fun. Make the anti-magic, which is like magic doesn't work. Well, who cares? That's just boring. Make it interesting. And that's a way. You could like, and so the, you know, just like 13th age damage resistance is either gonna be you roll high enough to not get stopped by it, or you are doing half damage. Make this somewhat similar in a sense it's not just turning magic off. Roll a save, and you're either doing half effect if you succeed, or we're having a fizzle. That'll be fun.
So I want to say on the anti-magic effect that when that monster came out in the 70s, it was had that anti-magic ray to turn off all the broken spells and
because it's
polymorphs
broken, right?
And magic items.
Don't hit me with that fireball.
Invisibility rings and all the crazy stuff that made the game weird.
So in other words, it was like an ecological response. The ecosystem was... The Beholder was a predator to the game needed.
The Game Master needed that effect. You don't need that effect in 13th Age because we don't have a bunch of broken effects that allow players to walk through every monster until they run into one with anti-magic. So, I mean, maybe you still want some sort of interesting anti-magic effect, but that was never the most interesting part of a Beholder. No. That was just the weird thing.
The eye rays are the fun part.
Characters in my campaigns didn't have magic items and crap anyway, so it didn't matter. Anti-magic, whatever. But I would say if you're going to do a beholder, you know, you really only have to do that once and make it really special. It doesn't have to be exactly balanced. You don't have to figure out exactly how it's supposed to work. Like when we design a monster, it's got to be right for hundreds of people to put into their games in a lot of different contexts, and it's got to work in all those ways. You just need something cool for the battle that you want to set up. So I would say, don't worry about it too much. Fudge the numbers. Fudge the die rolls a little so that it's the appropriate level of... You don't want to, like, you've got this one big battle with the Beholder. You don't want it all to go one way or the other just because the dice rolls put you in one direction.
No, so then what you do is you go ahead and make it so... Use the usual trick, which is where you make... Okay, every time the Beholder is using one of its eye rays, something interesting happens.
Something unfortunate to the player characters.
And it could be slightly unfortunate. Yeah. Just... Like, okay, that was a miss and not much of a fact, but something unfortunate.
Right.
Or it could be very dramatically unfortunate. So just make, don't let the beholder waste a die roll. When the beholder rolls the die, the response to the player characters is like, ha ha, that didn't work. No, they don't get to do that.
You could also, maybe the player characters in your campaign do have some irritating abilities that you want to shut down. And maybe there's an eye ray that just happens to... You know, make you sound strange so that the bard can't use their cool abilities or
and
whatever,
you explain
right?
to your players that what you're doing is channeling the original spirit of the Beholder game design. That this isn't directly, personally against them, even though it seems tailored to shut them down. This is more you being in touch with the spirit.
That's right.
Of who originally created the Beholder.
It's got to be Gygax
Was it Gygax?
Yeah, from
Greyhawk. Oh, it was really
Greyhawk.
Greyhawk.
Really,
yeah,
early.
Yeah, yeah. It was on the cover even. At one point.
Yeah, they knew they needed any magic really early.
All right, well, thank you.
Well, not only... Yeah, whatever.
Yeah.
You can see Gygax, like, how much fun he had the first time when he floated that thing in. Your items work.
The next question, I believe, is from your publisher, Simon Rogers.
Uh-oh.
Oh, yeah. Quick, Jonathan. Best behavior.
We'll be done really quick with that.
Comb your hair.
Script. Yeah.
If a monk uses spinning willow...
With come on, Simon! sorry.
If a monk uses spinning willow with a champion feat which redirects damage, does it also prevent any effect? For example, if an attack grabs the monk, is she still grabbed?
Yeah, Rob, we got a question on grab. You got an answer? Is she grabbed?
Well, I cheated a little because I had to look at the book before this. So the monk spinning willow works against ranged and close quarters attacks. So theoretically, if there was a range, there is no ranged attack that grabs you as far as I know. But theoretically, if there's a close quarters attack that also grabs you.
Well, it could make you stuck. It could do all sorts of things besides damage.
Well, yes. Okay, so he asked about
what they're asking, can things besides damage be transferred? You transfer some of the damage to somebody, can you
help?
Right.
No, I don't think so. I think the thing is, it could shut it down.
And you're also not subject to the effect. Like, you take no damage.
Right.
And you also take no...
I'm pretty sure the wording of it said that they take some damage. Did it also say transfer the effect?
Was it that you take half damage?
Hey, man, now we're sitting here... Okay, hold on.
Should we just tell Simon to read the book?
Well, yeah, no, please continue on with the questions while the so-called game designer does the research quickly. Because although, I think the part that's confusing Simon is that it uses language about deflecting the attack, which makes you feel like... The feel of that is like, oh yeah, I deflect the attack, and then it goes over, and it was going to poison me. Well, it poisons them or stuns them. It doesn't say anything about the. It only says you can choose one nearby enemy. It takes one quarter of the damage as you deflect the attack. And when I say that, I wrote that pretty deliberately. I did not think, oh, this should be so powerful. I thought to myself, no, there's just too many times that are weird if you say that all the effects get switched over to the other thing.
It's like damage.
it doesn't make sense. So it's just damage. So,
but in addition, it cancels out the effect on you as well.
It does. Yeah. Yep.
Okay. The next question is about leveling up. When you go up to 10th level, it appears there's pretty much no disadvantage at all to dual classing, particularly if you're already a spellcaster dual classing to another spell-using class.
This was a really good question by Simon.
Spells stop increasing in power at 9th. Is that right?
Well done, Simon.
I mean, in general, the way that spellcasting works for multi-class, since you're lagging one level behind, that matters most at odd levels, where you're getting a new spell level, and it matters less at even levels, and 10 is an even level. Something special about 10... 8 is like that, and 6 is like that, and 4 is like that.
So, in terms of lagging behind, that character would have the spells of the 9th level casters, not the 10th.
Yep.
The third paragraph in the multiclassing section talks about how probably you should multiclass early in a character's career. Or, if that's not the case, then the transformation of your character should be a really big deal. It should be set up, and it should be a major story event. Now, if somebody in my game was like, oh, I'm going to get 10th level. Hey, I'm going to get sorcerer level. I'm multiclassing, at the last minute. This has not come from anywhere. I'm just doing it. I'd be like, this isn't set up. This is just sort of a weird power grab.
So start laying pipe at 8th level. At 8th level, oh, I'm a sorcerer, and I'm really curious about those chaos mages, and I'm going to do whatever. And then we get to 10th level, you've laid the pipe for 2 levels, and you're like, okay, I can finally, I think my mind is open, and I can do sorcery plus chaos magery. But like, even in that example...
So you're not just doing ab-fab parenting, now you're doing like ab-fab, GMing?
If the players want to know how to... cheat the system, I will help them cheat the system.
Sure. This
customer is always right.
Oh!
No, just late. You want to do something with your character that's exceptional?
The publisher is even more right.
You got to lay pipe. You gotta lay that out there.
So that
it feels like a story.
Oh, stop it! So that it is a story.
There we go. All right, we agree on that.
That gives you 12 ninth level spells.
I'm just mocking you for no good reason.
Okay,
sorry.
Well, let's mercifully move on to questions kind of about the 13th Age product roadmap. The first one being, once 13th Age in Glorantha is complete, what 13th Age products are you working on next?
So, the two of us don't have any definite plans for which projects we're working on together.
We've talked about a couple.
Yeah, and so there's a couple possible possibilities that have not yet, in business terms or product terms, come to fruition. So, and it's certainly possible down the road that more with 13th Age and Glorantha is certainly possible. And
yeah, we had fun on that one.
Oh yeah, and it's also and there's another possibility but those negotiations are happening rather than settled, and I'm not entirely sure. You know, unclear. Yeah,
nothing we could say.
Nothing we can say. Nope.
Okay. Would you ever consider writing a sci-fi or space opera game using the Archmage engine?
This is an interesting question, because when it came in, like, all of a sudden we started considering it, thinking about it, like, you know, think about it.
You know.
Certainly there have been people who have, like, right away. There have been people who've been doing some interesting stuff with science fiction. I don't tend to run science fiction games, even though space opera, like Ian Banks and things like that, are like some of my favorite books. But I don't run them, so it hasn't been on my brain as something to do.
I mean, I'll say that 13th Age was really a labor of love, where, you know, we came together and used all the experience that we had to, you know, produce something really that only we could come up with, and, you know, we just don't have that same background in science fiction. Like, you know, it would be, we'd be starting much more from scratch if we came together and said, hey, let's do a science fiction game. Whereas, you know, doing the Dragon Empire, that was something that played right to.
And
know,
I guess Glorantha has the same style.
And we know Glorantha from way back, from, you know, 40 years or whatever.
So,
almost.
So in a weird way, so the question asks, have you considered, you know, would you consider? And I think it's unlikely that you and I are going to do a space opera together. I certainly think that one could be done with the Archmage engine. I don't necessarily see us doing it.
Unlikely seems like a fine adjective.
Okay. Yeah. All right.
Over time, are there new rules or options that you'd like to add to 13th Age, similar to the grappling rules that Rob wrote about? And will these appear in 13th Age Monthly?
Like, for me, not really. Like, there's lots of things that I would want to do differently. I would like Grab to be more vicious than it is, or whatever.
Right? That's
what you're doing. But no, and we're not, like, it's not, isn't even stuff that we have to house rule to make things work, or whatever, really. So, and the other thing is, we're not about the rules.
But when we did 13th Age of Glorantha, we added some rules.
Yeah.
And we did 13 True Ways, we added summoning rules, which 13th Age and Glorantha still works on.
Yeah.
So, I mean, in a weird way, I think
of those as systems, right? I wouldn't change any rules. We might add new systems, right? Like the summoning system.
Okay.
You know, whereas changing the way Grab works, is it a different rule? You know, here's a new rule for how initiative works. No, I don't think we're going to do that.
No, not really.
It's about the story anyway, right? Like, I mean, it's about the character's creativity.
Actually, this question is kind of like the Unearthed Arcana question, isn't it?
Yeah.
Like, with AD&D, it's like, do you want a whole bunch of variants for how to play? Now, the weird thing is, we already sort of put variants into the game to begin with, in some ways. So doing a whole, so we don't have it as a goal to go ahead and create more like that. I think that's one way to say it. It's like, you know, when something comes up, when there were problems come up, and we look at it, we'll be like, oh, what should we do about this? So I think one answer is, we have talked about other rule changes.
That's right.
And then have worked through it, and have ended up going, no.
Yeah.
Don't need to do it. So I don't want to do it. Yeah. And so I think there's an element of, you know, maybe you could say this is a process, and if it turns out that there are things that need to happen, well, like, you know, yeah, we will. But so far, not a whole lot that way. So,
yeah.
Good question.
Well, the next question is sort of similar, but there's a little bit of a twist on it. The game has been out for a few years, and you maybe have a different perspective. What would you change in a hypothetical second edition of 13th Age?
So, seriously, in Game Design Workshop mode, I wouldn't answer that question right now. Because, given that I can think of some serious answers, they belong in the second edition. They don't belong in... They don't help at all in the current Brit phase. And they just don't. If they did, that would be different. You know, it was like... So if there was something that would be like, oh, this is how it should be. But they don't, they, you know, any, the hypothetical answers to the hypothetical question are not relevant now, perhaps.
I mean, I'll say that I wish the Half-Orc's racial ability were stronger. Right? That would be nice.
Well, that could be handled via 13th Age Monthly.
No, I right.
You mentioned that.
Yeah.
Yeah, you're right. That's an example. And the Wood Elf perhaps less so. Yeah.
Yeah, we might change the Wood Elf's help and grace a little. And, you know, I would probably take another crack at the point by system, honestly.
Oh, of course.
But
even know. Even more than what you did with 13th Age of Glorantha.
Yeah.
But those are kind of very, not, that's pretty not that, small.
Yeah. That's right.
Yeah.
Next question is about a new class. The Warlock is the fan-made class that I see most often, with several variants available on the Vault of the 13th Age. Have you considered creating a Warlock that incorporates the 3rd edition, 4th edition, Essentials, and 5e version of the class, similar to how the 13 True Ways Druid was built?
Yeah, so Rob is really the guy that does the classes. So sure, he's happy to do another class for you. When do you want it?
I think the...
Or maybe not.
The direct answer to the question, have you considered that? The answer is no. And the reason is the Druid is a very involved character class. And it accomplished something in the sense that, well, I think it did. It attempted to go ahead and say, what kind of versions of a Druid have you played? Right. Well, here you go. Try doing it this way. I have not... So far, whenever I've started thinking about doing another character class that was like a Druid, I've realized that it would be an amazing amount of work, and it would require it would require something extraordinary to make it worthwhile. Like 13 True Ways was funded by the fans before we even finished and published the core book.
Yeah.
And, you know, there's an example of let's make something special and let's really work at it. So in the general workflow, doing a Warlock class that tried to incorporate all those different tracks it seems to me that there are things about the Warlock that could go into character class design, but I'm pretty sure that if I did it, it would not be with the Druid model.
I mean, and the other thing is, class design is the hardest work
it is.
In the whole process.
It is by four or five times.
Yeah.
I mean, it's like when I would like switch from class design to monster design or something like that. Like,
there's no comparison. And so, you know, I mean, honestly, a lot of people will produce hack versions of classes and share them around or whatever, but they don't...
Some of them might be good.
None of them are going to work to your level of... Like, you have this super high standard of how things work. In classes, and you know classes better, 13th Age classes better than anybody.
So I will say this, when I do a Warlock class, if I do one someday, it almost certainly won't be able to handle the Druid model.
Yeah.
But if you
ever do it, it would probably be part of a big project, because doing a class is a lot of work.
It seems like doing a part of a big project would be important. Yeah. And like, you know... Doing 13th Age of Glorantha did a lot of new classes,
right?
But that was a giant project, it felt right to do it then.
Yeah, that's right.
So, yeah.
And, oh. and you were working on those classes from the beginning to the end, right?
I was.
The hardest part of the whole game.
So, Gareth, writer Hanrahan, has designed a demonologist, and I think the demonologist uses a couple pieces of things that you might have found in certain versions of the world. You know, just concepts that are related to it. So, I think it's more likely, in a certain sense, that that things might appear in different places, and perhaps multi-classing could splice them together. Who knows? So, yeah.
Well, in a similar vein, somebody's asking if there's any possibility of a sword mage or a magus class.
You know, I hadn't thought about that before the question came in, but I realized that in all this time I've been working on 13th Age and Glorantha classes, I hadn't really been thinking about designing new core 13th Age classes. And a sword mage style class is certainly an interesting style design. I mean, for instance, the Wind Lord in 13th Age and Glorantha is a sort of a fighter variant with magical powers. Sword mage, you don't have to necessarily follow the ways that the class has been done in other editions of the game. You can do interesting magical effects because it's somebody, you know, two good things going together. So I could see it. Yeah. I mean, it's there's certainly some interesting design there, I could imagine it would happen someday. Yeah. This is not a timed promise.
Yeah, that's right.
Well, now we have a few questions about Glorantha. What significant changes can we expect with the Glorantha book?
There's all sorts of new stuff in Glorantha. We're old-time fans of the setting, and we poured a whole bunch of stuff into there. You know, there's new classes, a whole bunch of mystic rune gifts that you can just rescan as magic items. So new magic item powers, ton of new monsters with a bunch of new and interesting effects. There's rules for battle healing in a world where there are no clerics.
Or few.
Yep. Yeah. And a couple new races.
Yeah. And all the... For the most part, the Glorantha material can be used in the Dragon Empire. The whole thing about, people taking a devil and reskinning it as an Elder Awakened Treant. You can do that. And then 13th Age... And Glorantha, you probably don't have to do as much. A big part of the 13th Age of Glorantha monster chapter is a really fun monster conversion table where we took all the monsters that showed up and a ton of monsters from 13th Age Bestiary and 33 Ways and showed how they can be used in Glorantha.
Just reskin them and suddenly you've got the...
Reskin them and possibly say a couple words about don't use this power, use that power, and then all of a sudden it makes perfect sense with Glorantha. So the systems that Jonathan mentioned, the rune, is a different way of handling what 13th Age does with icon relationships.
Yeah.
It puts more of the focus on player narration of sort of a big effect, and it happens less often, so it's a much bigger deal when it does, and when a player uses it. I think it could be used straight out in the Dragon Empire, no problem.
There's a whole system for hero questing where you go to the other world, you know, the other side or the spirit plane, and you either recapitulate the heroic deeds of great gods or, you know, heroes and that sort of thing. And that stuff is really big in Glorantha, but you could find room for that sort of thing in Dragon Empire, too.
And I think that classes like, you know, the Earth Priestess is the first dedicated summoner with at will powers. The Hellmother is a hilarious... summoning spirits and releasing spirits that just do a tiny bit of damage to her allies while helping them. Tough love.
Yeah. Bug spirits, darkness spirits.
These things fitting into a core Dragon Empire game where you want them could be really fun.
Yep.
And have people designed a trickster class before in a sort of crunchy...
I've never seen anything like it.
Yeah. So the trickster is not, this is not the illusion, I cast illusions and everyone is confused. Well, everyone is confused, but it's not illusions. This trickster is a very, the scapegoat, all the bad luck goes on to them, and...
I sort of have a good luck charm for the team and a bad luck charm for themselves.
Yeah, and and sometimes when the trickster is missing from the game, the other player characters are very scared. So they're good to have along. So a whole bunch of stuff.
Yeah.
In fact, a bigger book than the core 13th Age book.
Really big.
And actually, we haven't seen what Jeff has added to it yet. Yeah. Oh, there we go.
Is there any support plan for the Glorantha setting?
There is a Snake by Paolo adventure that is on the way. Jonathan and I are not yet commissioned for doing support, but...
We have some ideas.
Yeah. I think that nothing else has been announced. I believe Snake by Paolo has been announced. No? Well, what do you know? If Wade doesn't edit this, it's announced now. All right.
All right, and finally, I mean, I don't know how we can follow that bombshell announcement. But what indie-er games would you suggest for those who are fond of 13th Age?
I'm a big fan of Apocalypse World.
Yeah, me too.
Yeah. By Vincent Baker. It's, the character sheets are great. The core mechanic is really interesting. The setting gives you lots of possibilities. I learned a lot playing it.
I have to admit that it's bad practice to go ahead and for me to like say, hey, these are great games when I haven't actually played them. And so my issue is that, you know, Apocalypse World I played and loved, and I haven't played a whole lot of other indie games lately. So my answer is not really going to be a good one. I'll go with yours.
Fate. Lots of people like Fate. Lots of people who like freeform games.
There is some crossover, definitely.
Like Fate.
Yep. And I admit I have not played it. So.
No, me neither.
You have not? Huh? We should get someone to run a game for us. Because I think that's better than us trying.
Yeah.
All right, and that's it for the questions for now.
All right.
Until we do this again.
Yay!
Yeah.
Good. Is there anything that you would like to add?
Hey, thanks for those of you who are new to the 13th Age Monthly subscribing. It's really good, and it's been a lot of fun to do. And see you later this month with Wade's Temple of the Sun Cabal.
And remember, Game Masters, just because you're handing out treasure doesn't mean you can't also be dealing damage.
Thanks a lot, guys.
All right.